We now want to look at how these equations depend on angle of attack and elevator deflection, or how they're related to angle of attack and elevator deflection. Angle of attack and elevator deflection are what we're going to call our operating conditions, and we'll see how they factor in here. So there are three terms that depend on angle of attack alpha, or elevator deflection delta E. The first one is the lift coefficient on the main wing, so CLW. We can actually rewrite that as a function of angle of attack. So we can write it as the lift slope of the main wing multiplied by the angle of attack plus the mounting angle of the wing minus the zero lift angle of attack of the wing. Okay, so that we could, if we knew all those parameters, we could tell what the lift coefficient on the main wing is. Likewise, we can do the same thing for the horizontal tail. So CLH is equal to the lift slope on the horizontal tail multiplied by alpha plus alpha naught H, so that's the mounting angle, minus alpha lift naught H, that's the zero lift angle of attack. And then recall that we talked about the fact that the main wing actually is producing downwash on the horizontal stabilizer. And so the angle of attack that we see, or that the horizontal stabilizer sees, is not necessarily the free stream angle of attack. What we have up here is the free stream angle of attack in both of these equations, but we need to decrease this angle of attack by our downwash angle epsilon D. Okay, so let's write epsilon D over here for just a minute. Epsilon D, that downwash angle, is directly proportional, we'll find out later, is directly proportional to the lift coefficient on the main wing. So as the lift increases on the main wing, the downwash increases proportionally. And so we can actually write this. So since lift coefficient on the main wing, actually we can come back over to this equation here. We can see that that is a linear function of angle of attack, and then these two are constant values. So actually, lift coefficient on the main wing is just a linear function of angle of attack. And so we can actually write epsilon D as some epsilon D naught plus epsilon D alpha times alpha. So in other words, what we're saying here is that if we were to plot this as a function of angle of attack, and this is our downwash, that we'd have a linear relationship here. We'd have epsilon D naught, that's the value when angle of attack is zero, and then the lift slope, or the slope of this line, would be epsilon d alpha there. And so we're just going to plug that in here. The downwash angle decreases our angle of attack. So we're going to say minus epsilon d naught and minus epsilon d alpha times alpha. Okay, so that's our downwash term in there that's affecting the lift coefficient on our horizontal. And then the last thing that affects the lift on the horizontal is our elevator deflection, and we're going to write that as an epsilon E times delta E. So delta E is actually the deflection of the elevator, and epsilon E is what we call an elevator effectiveness. And basically what it tells us is the ratio of the elevator deflection to angle of attack, or how the elevator deflection influences the lift coefficient, similar to the angle of attack. So for example, if the horizontal stabilizer were allowed to, the whole thing could rotate, okay? So we don't just have a portion of this that's the elevator, but we're using the entire horizontal stabilizer as the elevator, and it could rotate, then epsilon E would be 1, because that means that a deflection of the elevator would be equivalent to a change in angle of attack of the elevator. Okay, it's a 1-to-1 relationship. But for most aircraft, they just have a portion of the elevator that, or excuse me, a portion of the horizontal that deflects as the elevator. And so this epsilon would be less than 1, you know. So what would it say is if we have 1 degree elevator deflection, then let's say it's only 50% effective. And so 1 degree of elevator deflection is the equivalent of 0.5 times that 1 degree, that's equivalent to a half a degree in our angle of attack in terms of how it affects our lift coefficient. So hopefully that made sense. But anyway, so these are all the different things that we're then going to multiply our lift slope by, and that gives us the lift coefficient on the horizontal tail. Okay, the last thing that we need to discuss here that depends on the angle of attack or elevator deflection is actually the pitching moment of the horizontal tail. So the pitching moment of the horizontal, we're going to say, is equal to some value when the elevator is not deflected plus the change in pitching moment with respect to delta E times delta E. Okay, so for small elevator deflections, the pitching moment on the horizontal is basically a linear relationship with elevator deflection, okay? And of course, the pitching moment on the horizontal is independent of angle of attack because we're saying that this pitching moment is located at the aerodynamic center. Remember, this pitching moment of the main wing and the pitching moment of the horizontal, those are located at the aerodynamic centers of those lifting surfaces. So they do not change with angle of attack. But the pitching moment on the horizontal does depend on the elevator deflection. Okay, with that, we can plug now these three expressions into our lift equation and also into our moment equation here. And we could write these out. I'm actually going to write out the lift equation in a special form here. So we could just plug those in and write out those equations, but I'm going to divide up the lift equation just a little differently. I'm going to first put everything that is proportional to alpha. So you can imagine once I've plugged in the lift equation, we just have these two terms here, right? So I'm going to plug in this for that for the lift coefficient on the wing and CLH here for the horizontal. And now I'm going to pull out everything that is proportional to alpha. So for example, CL wing alpha, when I plug this term in up here, we have this CL W alpha that's proportional to alpha. So I'm going to put that in here. So we have CLW alpha. And then from the horizontal, the term that we have there we've got an alpha here and an alpha there. And those are multiplied by CLH alpha, which then once we've plugged this into here, are also multiplied by these terms here. So I'm going to write those there. So we've got eta sub H times SH over SW CLH alpha. And then we've got the alpha term and the epsilon d alpha inside of that. And so I'm going to say 1 minus epsilon d alpha. Okay, so this is all the stuff that is proportional to alpha. So I'm going to say it's all of that stuff multiplied by alpha plus I'm going to do all of the stuff multiplied by delta e. And it turns out that it's not very much of that. We just have this term right in here, this epsilon e delta e. That's inside of CLH, that's inside of this term here. So what we get there is SH over SW eta sub H CLH comma alpha times epsilon E. So that's all the stuff multiplied by delta E. And then everything else I'm gonna move over to the right-hand side. And all I'm doing is rewriting this equation in a different form here. So I've got everything on the left-hand side that's proportional to alpha and delta E. And I'm going to move the rest of this stuff over to the right-hand side. And you see on the right-hand side, we already have that CW cosine gamma. So I'll start with that. And then the other stuff we need to move over includes a minus CL wing alpha times alpha not wing minus alpha lift not wing. And then from the horizontal term, we have a minus SH over SW times eta H times CLH alpha. I've got a alpha not horizontal minus alpha lift not horizontal minus epsilon D not. Okay, so these are all the terms that were left. Okay, so basically what we've done here is just plugged these expressions into this equation and rearranged it. So we have everything proportional to alpha here, everything proportional to delta E, then everything else on the right-hand side. And the reason we've done that is because these terms actually have really specific meanings. So this first term here is the lift slope of the entire aircraft, CL alpha, for the entire airplane. This here is the change in lift with respect to elevator deflection. So that's the change in lift on that whole aircraft with respect to elevator deflection. And then the stuff on the right, this first term here, we'll call this CL. And actually we can see that the way that we've written this up here, CL is equal to a bunch of this stuff, which is equal to CW cosine gamma. So this is just the lift coefficient on the entire aircraft, okay? And then the stuff that's left over here, all of this is the lift coefficient that is produced on the aircraft. We're going to call it CL0 because this is the lift coefficient that is produced by the aircraft when both alpha and delta E are zero. So if alpha and delta E were zero, then all of this stuff wouldn't matter. And this is all the stuff that's left here. This is the lift coefficient on the airplane when alpha and delta E are zero. So we can do the same thing with the pitching moment equation. We can take these three equations and plug them in to where they go into these equations here, of course, CMH, CLW, and CLH there. And we could rearrange those the same way that we've done here. We'd get some term times alpha plus another term times delta E. And then because we had a zero on the right-hand side, when we move everything over here, we're going to call this equal to minus CM naught. And that CM naught is, again, the pitching moment when alpha and delta E are zero. And then let's label these terms in here. This is going to be called CM alpha. So that's a change in pitching moment with respect to alpha on the entire aircraft. And this is the change in pitching moment with respect to delta E on the entire aircraft. So this is just another way to look at the lift and the pitching moment equations. So this is the lift equation, and this is the pitching moment equation there, okay? So the reason we can do this is because below stall, the aerodynamics is basically linear. You notice that all of these terms are linear. You know, we've got these, alpha is multiplied by some slope out here, right? Alpha is multiplied by a slope. Alpha here is multiplied by some constant. We assume that the pitching moment changed in a linear form here with delta E. And so we're able to divide it up this way where we have just a bunch of constants basically multiplied by alpha, constants multiplied by delta E, and then some stuff on the right-hand side, and same with the lift equation. So these are linear relationships, and this is pretty true below below stall, is that our aerodynamics is basically linear with control deflections and angle of attack. These two parameters here are what we call aerodynamic derivatives. And these two parameters here, CM delta E and CL delta E, are what we call control derivatives, okay? So these two here are control derivatives, and these two are called aerodynamic derivatives, all right? And this is just another way of looking at it. Now, we know that we have to satisfy both of these equations in order for this aircraft to be trim. And so another way to look at this problem is that we're going to have CL alpha, CL delta E, CM alpha, CM delta E as a 2x2 matrix. Our unknowns are alpha and delta E, and that's equal to CL minus CL zero, and then minus CM zero here. Okay, so this is one way to write it, and the way that we've set it up here is we've treated alpha and delta E as unknowns. And so those, the rest of the information in here are basically constants based off of the design. So we can go back and look at that. You know, the area of the horizontal, the area of the wing, C bar, CW, eta sub H, that's our tele-efficiency factor, the location of these, you know, where the wing is sitting relative to the center of gravity. We have mounting angles, zero lift angles of attack, that depends on our airfoil. So basically, once we have a design, we know all of the information in this matrix. We know all the information on the right-hand side. Well, this lift coefficient actually here depends on our operating condition. So that's going to change. Remember, that's this guy here. That's going to depend on our weight and our altitude and velocity and our climb angle. So that term there will change based off of operating condition. But everything else is based off of the design of the aircraft. And so based off of the design, we can and an operating condition here, we can then solve for alpha and delta E that are required to trim the aircraft. So this is going to be the angle of attack and the elevator deflection that the pilot commands elevator deflection. And once he does that, as long as the aircraft is stable, the aircraft will find the angle of attack that trims out these equations. Okay, so again, this is a simplified analysis. Remember that we've made some assumptions about all of these things lying on the fuselage reference line, and the thrust is aligned with the direction of flight, and we've used small angle approximation. Anyway, there's a lot of simplifications that have gone into this, but the underlying fact is still true, or the insights that we gain from these are true across most aircraft, that you can write this basic equation like this and then solve for alpha and delta E for your operating condition. And so we'll do some example problems and homework that where we have to set up the problem this way and then solve for alpha or delta E. Sometimes you might be given alpha and delta E, but because you have two equations, there may be two other unknowns up in all of these equations up here. Because we have two equations, you can have two different unknowns that you're solving for. So anyway, we'll look at different things like that.